Directions. Now you will hear some talks and discussions about academic topics. Each talk or discussion is followed by four or more questions. Choose the best answer to each question and mark the letter of the correct answer on your answer sheet. You will hear each talk or discussion only one time. Number 15. Questions 26 through 29. Listen to a teacher talking in a history class.
Almost no other ancient culture gave women as many rights as ancient Egypt. They could buy and sell land and goods, and even divorce their husbands. Still, the head of the family was the father. When he died, his eldest son became its head. Most Egyptians couldn't read or write. Only a few upper-class boys and girls went to special schools where they were taught to become scribes. Such scribes wrote official government documents. Most boys became farmers and craftsmen. They followed their fathers and took on the same jobs. Girls were trained to become mothers and to give birth to children. They learned household chores from their mothers. Bread, made from wheat, was the main source of food in ancient Egypt. Richer families also had vegetables, fish, and meat to eat. Middle and lower class people drank beer. The upper classes drank wine. Food was prepared on clay stoves. Almost all Egyptians wore white clothes. Men wore skirts or robes, and women wore skirts or dresses with shoulder straps. While most people went barefoot, richer people wore sandals on their feet. Women were very fond of wearing makeup. They painted their fingernails and put red powder on their lips. They also dyed their hair in many colors. Men and women liked wearing rings and other jewelry. Egyptian houses were made of dried mud and had flat roofs. Poor people lived in simple huts, while the richer people in the cities lived in buildings that had up to three floors. The houses had small windows to keep out the sun and help the house stay cool. Ancient Egyptians did many different things in their free time. They liked to go swimming and fishing in the Nile River. Hunting crocodiles, lions, and other wild animals were popular sports among ancient Egyptians.
Now answer the questions. 26. What's the main topic of the lecture? What was the main source of food in ancient Egypt? 28. What was the difference between the poor and the rich? 29. What were the Egyptian houses like? 16. Questions 30 through 33. Now you will hear part of a radio program.
Hello, listeners. Today I will be speaking about weight and mass with Dr. Nicole Bell from the University of Melbourne. Thank you for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
Dr. Nicole Bell, does a person get lighter the higher above the earth they move? If so, do they get heavier the closer to the center of the earth they move, such as down a mineshaft? That is to say, does your weight change as you move above or below the earth's surface?
Well, weight is the way we usually describe what the scales tell us. But our weight is actually something different. When you get on the scale and it tells you that you weigh 50 kilograms, that isn't your weight. That's actually your mass. In everyday speech, weight and mass are used interchangeably, but weight is a figure arrived at by multiplying mass by gravitational acceleration.
But I can't understand yet. Can you give us an example?
Okay. Physics use Newton's second law, F equals ma, to describe the forces acting upon an object moving through space, where force is equal to mass times acceleration. In the case of weight, we can describe the force as W equals mg.
That means that weight is equal to mass times gravitational acceleration. Is that so?
Yes, of course. Weight is not measured in kilograms, but in newtons.
Really?
For example, the gravitational acceleration for everyone standing on Earth is 9.8 meters per second squared. If my mass is 50 kilograms and I'm standing on the surface of the Earth, I multiply it by 9.8 and my weight is 490 newtons.
Oh, that's very interesting.
As you travel away from the Earth's surface, your mass stays the same, but your weight reduces as gravitational pull decreases. For example, an astronaut orbiting the Earth and floating weightlessly in the cabin still has the same mass. If it were possible to put them on scales in that situation, they would be the same number of kilograms as they were on Earth. However, their weight in newtons would have reduced.
Then why can we experience weight on the Earth?
When you're standing on Earth, you experience weight because you've got the ground pushing up against your feet. The experience of weight is through that counteracting force of the ground pushing back on you as you're pushing down on the ground, because gravity is pulling you down. If you're in a spaceship, you don't feel weight because you don't have the ground pushing up against you.
I see. It's very kind of you to tell us so much.
Now answer the questions. 30. Which is true about weight? What can be inferred from the program? 32. Which is true about mass? 33. Why can we experience weight on the Earth? 17. Questions 34 through 38. Now you will hear a speaker talking to a class on a trip to Dubai.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for visiting Dubai. I hope you can enjoy yourselves here. Dubai is like no other place on Earth. It is the world capital of living large, a city of big business, luxury hotels, skyscrapers, and huge shopping malls. In the early 20th century, Dubai was a successful trading port. People from all over the world stopped in Dubai to do business. But it was still a small city, and most people lived as fishermen, merchants, or by raising animals. Then in 1966, oil was discovered. In time, this brought a lot of money into the region, and soon Dubai began to change. Today, Dubai is one of the world's most influential business centers. In fact, each year, most of the city's annual earnings come from business, not oil. The city is also a global trading port. Recently, Dubai has become a popular spot for tourists. People from abroad come to relax on its beaches, and every year millions visit just to go shopping. Dubai is also one of the world's fastest-growing cities. Construction is everywhere. Buildings, some of the tallest on Earth, are built in months. The city also has a number of man-made islands. One of these, the Palm Jumeirah, is shaped like a palm tree and is particularly beautiful. The city is still an amazing mix of people from different backgrounds. Individuals from 150 countries live and work in Dubai, and foreigners now outnumber Dubai natives 8-1. Many people welcome the city's growth, but increasing number of Dubai natives have concerns about the speed of change. As Mohammed Al-Abar, a Dubai business owner, says, "We must always remember where we came from. Our kids must know we worked very, very hard to get where we are now, and there's a lot more work to do."
Now answer the questions. 34. What is Dubai like? 35. What did most of the people not do in Dubai in the early 20th century? 36. Where do the most of the city's annual earnings come from? 37. What is the feature of population in Dubai? What do the native people think of the city's change? 18. Questions 39 through 42. Listen to part of the discussion in a science class.
If I was not compressing the gas, would the air be moving?
I do not think so.
I will write it here as a scientific claim. If you do not compress the gas, it will not move. Think about our question for a minute. How do I smell things from a distance? If we do not compress the gas, it will not move. Does anybody want to argue this claim or support it? If it is only moving when it is compressed, then you would have to compress everything to smell because the odor is traveling to our nose. What do you think about that?
I am not sure.
Okay, so you do not call this a claim, but you are asking, is this true? What do you think of Melissa's argument?
I think I like it.
What kind of evidence would you need to make sure that you felt okay with this?
The reason I think it can move. The air is moving even if it is not compressed. If the air could not move, you would not be able to inhale it. So, we would not be able to breathe. I think that if we had a kind of gas in a jar and opened that jar, some of the gas could leave the jar, and we would not have done anything except moving the top of the jar, which is not compressing.
Aha! So, he is telling us to go back to the very first day, when the class originally smelled each substance. If I just take the lid off, I am not really compressing the gas, right? Could we smell it?
Yes.
So now, it looks like we have evidence that we might want to get rid of our original claim, right?
Yes.
Now, answer the questions. 39. What's the topic of the discussion? 40. What's the girl's attitude to the boy's opinion? 41. How did the boy prove his view? 42. What's the result of this discussion?